data. I'm going to talk about technology spillovers and land use change, empirical evidence from global agriculture. So, so what I do here, it's really pay attention on how to capture indirect land use effects. This is the focus of this paper. This paper, it was great that Tom presented before I'm presenting. It will fall just in that between the segmented markets and the geography of trade. I'll fall short of general equilibrium. It's a partial equilibrium paper, but I'm going to be pretty detailed about how to use this sort of a modeling tradition of international trade to get at these results. Motivation. Derek Byerly, it's now the editor of Global Food Security, was in the standing panel of impact assessment on the CGR. This was almost 6 or 7 years ago. And he contacted Tom and I at the GTAP Center and said, we are getting a lot of criticism and resistance to the idea that investments in research and development for agriculture and the productivity growth following those investments are good for the environment. And this is being cast as a debate between Borloo hypothesis, Borloo being the father of the Green Revolution, that in some papers said that if there had not been yield growth over the 60s, we would have used much more land with all the environmental externalities, negative environmental externalities that would entail. Again, Jevons' paradox basically says that when you increase the efficiency of a resource, of a factor, land in this case, you end up using more of that. So in this seemingly contrasting set of views is where the CGR was getting that kickback towards research and development. And we start doing work on that. I engaged with Tom, that paper about the Green Revolution. It's a product of that. And something that I learned doing this was that there are two critical issues. The elasticity of demand faced by producers in the innovating region. Tom made a remark that a single farmer in a country that is well integrated to the world market faces a huge market, and in those cases that's an elastic demand. Probably there will be land expansion. And then the subject of this workshop, spillovers or land use leakage from the innovating region onto other regions. We had the experience with the biofuel debate that this was critical for the conclusions, and we saw that missing there. Now, even though the theoretical insights are neat and sharp, and we can reduce that to some parameters, we lack comprehensive empirical, and when I say empirical, it's econometric, it's not CGI, it's actually looking at the data, evidence on whether technological progress increases or decreases deforestation. And this is the objective of this work. To be sure, there are scores of papers looking at that question out there. Many, many, many. Jevons' paradox shows up very often. Angelsen et al. Volume. It's a number of case studies in tropical countries on tropical commodities that find that idea that yes, when there is an introduction of a technology, you actually increase land use. Very few cross-country studies, and perhaps the best known is Rudel et al. In this paper, basically Rudel and co-authors compare rates of yield growth from the 60s to the late, to the mid 2000s, and rates of harvested area, and conclude that yield growth did not save land. I have a deep critique of those studies, not just Rudel, the others that are cited here. A big one, they fail to control for other drivers of area growth. So those are unconditional estimates. We have important things like demand that were happening at that time. The other critique is that there is not a counterfactual against which measure the effect of yield growth or technology. What would be the alternative situation? Spillover effects are ignored in all this literature cross-country, and there is also this issue that yield growth, it's an incomplete measure of technological progress because it confounds intensification. You put more fertilizer or you do some practice that increases production with growth in productivity, the actual shift in the production function that you would have, for example, by using an improved seed. So in this paper, what I do, it's develop a unified framework using an Armington trait model that basically treats the geography of trade explicitly, that is going to link foreign technological change to land use decisions in a cross-section of countries, okay? I'm gonna use total factor productivity as a measure of productivity that gives us the pure shift in the production function. And I answer two critical questions for this literature. Does technological progress reduce cropland expansion? And how does agricultural technological progress in a given region influence land use in other regions? I'm going to be pretty formal in what I'm gonna present here. There will be some excess of mathematics, but bear with me, I think it's useful because the point of this presentation is to basically explain how these linkages can be explicit in a trade model. So we start with a pretty basic model in which a home region produces an agricultural good. There are other J countries, they also produce agricultural good. They all consume and they trade those goods. We'll have four building blocks: technology and prices, demand, supply, and an equilibrium. And the whole model, it's linearized in logarithms. So it's a linear model, linear equation that simplifies life quite a bit. We start with this critical relationship. This is the percentage change in the price that country I charges for a given agricultural good. Okay, so lowercase are percentage changes. Using profit maximization, we can basically decompose that change in prices in the changes on the land rents and the non-land input prices, weighted by the cost shared in the production function. So that's the idea that an increase in prices should be exhausted by increasing in the cost of the inputs that go into production. And pretty importantly, we have the TFP shifter. The take home of this slide is that when you have a positive percentage change in this variable, prices go down. So TFP growth makes a given country, the product of a given country, cheaper, more competitive in the world market. If we go back to Tom's slides, that I don't have them here, but that shift in the supply curve when you have technological change, that's what we are capturing right here. So let's keep this equation in mind. I'll use it shortly. And this is the center of the trade model, okay? So this is a constant elasticity of substitution, or CS preferences. If you have heard of the gravity model of international trade, this is what underlies this model. And this is basically the system of preferences that we use in every single modern treatment of international trade theory, from Paul Krugman, before from Armington, up to today. And what we have here, so the point is it's pretty standard stuff. And what we have here is a percentage change in the demand for agricultural goods in country I. So this is how much goods are demanded from one country. The beauty of the CS function is that we can decompose this change in two chunks. One is expansion. So stop the watch. I need everything. So the expansion effect. Let me parse this out. So it is important.
Left side.
What we have here, it's the changes in demand. So think the change of GDP per capita, and these are sales shares. This gamma here. So this is how much of the total production of country I goes to market J, and that's a weight on the change in GDP per capita in country J. So think about this as the US, this is China. If there is a big percentage change in GDP in China, and the sales shares of the US in China is large, the expansion effect is quite large. Now, you could have the same percentage change in another country, a very low sales share, the US is indifferent to that change. So that starts getting us a little bit closer to a geography of trade. There are differential relationships across countries as they trade. And then there is a substitution effect, that is where most of the action of what I'm looking for will come from. Key parameter, the elasticity of the substitution. This is the Armington elasticity of substitution across suppliers. And then we have this ugly looking term here, this omega ik, and let me show you what this is so I don't get too confused. It's a product of that, of those cell shares of what country I sells in market J, times the budget share of what country J buys from another country K. So let's fix ideas. I is the US, K are, it's Argentina. They both compete in the Japanese market. So the, we have this term omega that is basically the product of how much of the US sales go to Japan and how much of the Japanese total consumption comes from Argentina. When we sum over all the markets J, so Japan, Korea, the US itself, etc., we get a measure of the competition between countries I and K. So in this case, the US and Brazil. And we can do this for every country, for every pair of countries in the world. It's a measure of how close the producers are by virtue of competition in a third market, okay? Now, that term comes back here, and it's basically a difference between the relative prices that the US and Argentina are charging in those markets weighted by that competition. So if this is pretty high, right, and the price of country I goes up relative to the price of country K, this is positive, this is negative, there is a reduction in the demand for what this country is producing. It just got more expensive relative to a very important competitor. If there is no competition whatsoever, this is irrelevant, it's just an expansion effect. So the strength of the difference between prices, it's regulated by this. And then this parameter. When Tom was talking about an integrated world market, this is pretty large, okay? So any difference in prices causes what we call a flip-flop solution or a corner solution. If price I goes cheaper, you buy everything from country I. In practice, these are relatively low, and there are differential responses that we cannot explain by differences in prices alone. There are other factors there, trade relationships and whatnot, that are pretty important. And that's what we exploit to get this geography of trade. So I told you that I was going to just back this equation here. And what we are going to do with that is we are going to get here, substitute the price P sub I and P sub K by these expressions. And what I'm going to gain is to put the demand in country I now in terms of TFP growth terms, relative land rents and the relative prices of the non-land inputs. This is what I do here. I'm omitting the other terms, but what I have now is the demand in country I, the expansion effect, and now it's in terms of relative TFP gains. So I'm getting a bit closer to what I want, that it's to relate the changes in TFP abroad to the land use decisions in country I. And we have the same story. Depending on the size and the movements, the strength of competition, and the substitutability among sources, we'll have more or less of a demand response. I think we can put this aside for a second and go to the supply side, because at the end of the day, we are after land use. We get the demand for land as a derived demand. That's it. We have a production, so this is a supply of country. As you have more supply, you need more inputs, land amongst them. So the derived demand for land in a CS production function can be simplified again into these two effects, expansion effect and substitution. The expansion effect, it's simply the fact that if you produce more, you need more land, okay? That's net of technological change. So this is Borloff's hypothesis at work. If you have more production and you become more productive, you need less land. So you have that trade-off there. And there is a substitution effect that has to do, in this case, with your ability to substitute away from land in the production process. So this is the price of the non-land input, and this is the input substitution elasticity. So even though we have Borloff's hypothesis here, we also know that in equilibrium, this supply equals this demand that is giving us a richer relationship between technological progress at home and abroad. So that's what I do next. I rewrite these terms using that demand equation, and I get the obvious equation in the paper that is this one over here. But you know, I think it's worthwhile because now we have a very explicit relationship between the change in land in country I as a function of the price of the non-land input, fertilizers and whatnot, technological progress, and changes in demand, and also the relative changes in technological progress vis-a-vis its competitors, weighted by those competition indices. And they also enter, and we also have the changes in non-land input prices, so these are the input costs, and in land rents, and then some bunch of parameters that are here. Now, one reason the CS preference system is so popular is that this is a linear equation. So we can basically multiply this through, put all the parameters together, call them betas, and estimate this using OLS. And that's what we are going to do here. So these are parameters to be estimated, and this is data. TFP in country I, the relative changes in TFP weighted by competition shares, same with land rents, non-land input prices, demand, and in some specifications I can separate domestic from foreign. So, and then the only variable that it's not coming from the theory is this variable here that it's basically how much of the total area suitable for agriculture in a country was under cropland at a given point. And the idea here is that you may have some simultaneity between a country's TFP growth and its land use change. If, for example, a country is very limited in terms of land, they invest a lot in research and development, and they have high rates of TFP growth, yet they don't use a lot of land. So this is what we try to control here for. So we can take this equation to data, and the data, it's basically a two-period panel data, a cross-section of 70 countries, starting in 1991. The main reason of this is that before 1991, trade in agricultural products was very limited to Europe and the US and other countries with large demand. It's after mid-90s when the WTO kicks in that we start having a denser trade network. Cropland come from FAO. The non-land input prices are proxied by implicit fertilizer prices using Fugli's 2012 growth accounting framework. We can talk about that later. I'm going to skip over the details, but this same growth accounting framework is used by Fugli to produce the changes in TFP growth. So that's the data we are using there. We proxy changes in demand by GDP per capita. The land rents are also from the growth accounting framework using FFL data. And the competition indices are built using production and consumption from FAOstat and bilateral exports from the GTAP database. And L-bar, this variable, it's basically cropland at the beginning of the period divided by land suitable for agriculture, the index built by Ram and Cotty and collaborators. These are the regression results. I'm not going to spend a lot of time about them, and just going to make two remarks. All this data has explanatory power on the land use dynamics that we have observed over time. And the nice thing about following the theory is that we have a good expectation about signs. All these signs are as a theory would predict. So statistically, we have support for the model is the bottom line. And here we can then answer the question, well, it is Jevons' paradox, or it's the Borloss hypothesis. And as you may guess, it's an economist talking, the answer is going to be, it depends. And it's going to depend on this term. So what I did here for full transparency, it's basically take the derivative of the dependent variable against a domestic TFP growth. So we have beta 1 minus beta 2 times this, because the variable is inside here. So this is what the way we observe Jevons' paradox or the other. So what's happening here? A country that competes with no other country, that is fully closed, that is in an autarky, that country will have definitely a negative response. Its land will have a negative response to TFP shocks. Okay? It's Borloo hypothesis at its best. Now, as the countries start being opener and opener, this starts to cancel out this. There is a breaking point, it's around 0.25, where it's actually neutral. And after that, actually, this term is larger than this, and you start having Jevons' paradox. I'll show that by country in a second. But we also have a very interesting parameter here, that is how much land use change a TFP shock in country K causes in country I. And that's going to be this number that we estimated times the competition index. If two countries are fully unrelated, there will be no TFP transmission whatsoever. If two countries are very deeply integrated, they'll have an effect. This allows me to estimate foreign cropland elasticities to TFP growth. Needless to say, all this is based on OLS, beta parameters, so the delta method, or your preferred way of eliciting standard errors, helps to get these bars that I have here. So I'm going to magnify this a bit so you guys in the back can see something, Toby.
Yes, I'm just letting you know that we're going into the question time.
How much do I have left?
There's 10 minutes of questions starting now. So okay.
Well, I'm going to wrap it up real quick. So this is the domestic cropland elasticity. This is how much a percent of TFP growth changes land use in the countries in the Americas. This is 1991, 2000, and I'm going to focus in two countries here, Canada here. It's a country where you have Jevons' paradox, no doubt about that. We can see that's happening. But look at the US, for example. It's a pretty neutral response that is changing over time as markets get more integrated. It's moving towards Jevons' paradox. So it's pretty consistent with Tom's idea of an integrated market being more less friendly for resources. These are the cropland elasticity, foreign cropland elasticity. So this is 1% increase in TFP growth in the US reduces global cropland expansion by around 0.07% in the rest of the world. So this is the indirect land use effect that we measure here. And you can see that it's not always, if you see Canada, for example, here, very little indirect land use effect. So it's only Jevons' paradox. In the case of the US and most countries, the total elasticity tend to be negative, okay? We have this for all the countries, and you can see, let me show you this quickly before I wrap this up. We have Africa here. This is a region of the world, pretty poorly integrated, where you have most of the countries where technological saving is still, technological progress is still land saving, that changing as we move to more integrated markets, okay? We are moving towards Jevons paradox. And then we have Asia, same situation. It's more where still there are a lot of countries where technology is land saving. Europe made this transition a long time ago, though it has significant negative indirect land use effects. And just to wrap up before you call me, that I know you are very close to, I want to deal with the issue of demand and technology and how these two forces basically go against each other, the Jevons paradox and Borloo hypothesis when you take a global view. And the question here, was agricultural technological progress between 1990 and 2000 large enough to counteract the huge growth in demand that we saw? And we can use these parameter estimates for a counterfactual. And what I do here is basically, this is what we observed in the 20 years, 8.46 million hectares. This is the prediction of the model, centered around zero. It's you know, statistically, there was no change there. This is only TFP and demand, so pretty close to what we observed. And here, we shut down any growth in TFP. This is just demand. So as you can see, the confidence interval start overlapping each other. We would have used much more land, around 200 million hectares, if we had not had that TFP growth. So this is evidence that TFP growth was a pretty powerful force, basically counteracting the growth in demand. And this happens even though individual countries may have more land use as they improve their technology, okay? Conclusions. The direct land use effects, in most countries of the world, TFP growth is either uncorrelated or positively associated with land use, cropland expansion. The exception are some countries in Africa and in Asia. However, because of indirect land use effects, growth, TFP growth has been an important source of global land savings. So I think I'm going to stop here so we can go into the questions. Sorry about going over. Thank you.